Section 10.5, boiling point elevation and freezing point depression. I know for sure that you guys are going to do a lab on this. Really common lab. This is how ice melter works, right? So they're going to go put salt on the road. They're going to melt some of that ice because you're going to engage in a freezing point depression or lowering. It's going to freeze at a lower, colder temperature. Opposite happens to boiling. You're going to elevate that boiling temperature too. Thing with the boiling temperature, do you already know that that's going to happen? Of course you do. What happened to the vapor pressure as you added some solute? As you added solute in there, those surface sites got blocked. Your vapor pressure decreased. So to get the same vapor pressure, say one atmosphere for boiling, you're going to need to put in more heat, more energy, more temperature, elevated temperature. So your temperature for your boiling point is going to go up. And your temperature for your freezing point is going to go down. The presence of a solute is going to affect the freezing point and the boiling point of a solvent because of changes in state depend on that vapor pressure. So these are called colligative properties. They include freezing point depression, boiling point elevation, and we're going to see in a little bit osmotic pressure as well. So if you guys are into biology, osmotic pressure will show up in your life again to haunt you, but we'll talk about that when we get to it. We're really going to help characterize the nature of a solute after it is dissolved in a solvent and determine the molar masses of substances so we can figure out what is our molar mass. If we know how many grams went into it, we can figure out how many moles based on our change in freezing point or boiling point. If we've got moles and we've got mass, we've got a molar mass. This is because these colligative properties depend only on the number and not the identity of the solute particles in an ideal solution. All right, so this is an important concept. It is just the number. How many do we have? Not what is it? So 1 mole of NaCl, doesn't care that it's Na and Cl. It could be NaI. It could be NaF, right? It's going to split up into two ions. If I've got calcium chloride, well, that's going to be very different than sodium fluoride, not because the calcium is different from the sodium, but because the calcium chloride is going to be CaCl2 and dissociate into three things instead of two. Right? Our normal boiling point of a liquid occurs at the temperature where the vapor pressure is going to be equal to 1 atmosphere. And it's called normal point because we're going to assume 1 atmosphere is normal. If we had a higher pressure situation where we're like working in a hyperbaric chamber where it's under high pressure, that might be a higher temperature. If it's at a high elevation where our atmospheric pressure is lower, it's going to be a lower temperature. Non-volatile solutes are going to lower the vapor pressure of the solvent. So a solution has to be heated to a higher temperature than that of a pure solvent to reach a vapor pressure at 1 atm. And there are actually some clever things you can do, like in organic chemistry, to figure out if you have a pure substance. So if you know you've gone through and you synthesized this molecule and you know what its melting point should be, the closer you are to that melting point, that theoretical melting point, the more pure your substance is. The more contaminants, the sloppier you were, the larger the deviation, the lower that melting point is going to be. So you're going to use this melting point apparatus in organic chemistry quite a bit. So our boiling point elevation. Non-volatile solute elevates the boiling point of the solution in a very simple way. So love the equations in this chapter. They're real simple. It's like a thing is equal to a thing times another thing. Right? So here we've got our change in temperature is going to be related to this value KB times the molality. So remember, Henry's law was like C is equal to K times P, right? This guy is delta T, or it's our boiling point elevation. How much did it go up? Is going to be related to some KB. It's the molal boiling point elevation constant, and that's going to be dependent on each solvent. Right? The identity of the solute does not matter, but water is going to have a KB, ethanol will have a KB, everything's going to have a KB with it, but it's going to be unique to that solvent, not the solute. And then M, the molality of the solute in solution. So remember, molality was that one we were going to use because it doesn't change with change in temperature. And here we're looking at deliberately changing temperature. Right, so we can't use molarity, which is moles per liter. We have to use molality. Right, so we can't use big M, moles per liter. Right, this guy's out. We got to use little m, moles per kilogram of solvent. Right, let's see what this does to our phase diagram. So if we have a change in the freezing point, right, our freezing point is going to happen at a lower temperature. It started out here, it's going to shift over here. And our vapor pressure is going to be lower. So this line here is going to drop. So it's like you take this whole thing and you shift it down and to the left. You move it down and to the left, right? Our boiling temperature has moved over, right? Because this line has shifted down, our boiling temperature now moves over to the right, has to happen at a higher temperature. So our boiling point goes up, our freezing point goes down. The boiling point of the solution is higher than that of pure water, and the freezing point is lower than that of pure water. Here are some of those values combined for us in a table. We're all pretty familiar with good old-fashioned dihydrogen monoxide. We know it boils at 100 degrees C. Its value for Kb in terms of degrees C times kilograms per mole. So if you look at this guy over here, what's this the inverse of? Molality, right? Inverse of molality. Or it's going to be moles per kilogram. So that'll cancel out. It's going to be 0.51. It's different than carbon tetrachloride, which is different than camphor, which is different than carbon disulfide. If we look at our freezing point for water, we know that's going to happen at 0 degrees C. And our value for Kf, in terms of degrees C times kilograms per mole, or inverse molal, is 1.89. All right, so in terms of trends, you know, there's not really much we can come up with in terms of trends. The Kb values are generally smaller than the Kf values, but, you know, you can't really say, well, it's carbon disulfide is nonpolar, so it's going to be lower than water. Right? Note that these do not care what you dissolved, right? Kilograms and moles, it doesn't say identity of the moles, just how many things are in that solution. So let's do an example. We've got a solution that's prepared. We're going to dissolve 18 grams of glucose. How many things does glucose dissolve into? Right. It's got a boiling point of 100.34. So this is a deviation. When we put in that 18 grams of glucose, we see our new boiling point happens at 100.34. Can we calculate the molar mass of the glucose? Well, that's job number one. And job number two, right? So glucose is a molecular solid that's present as individual molecules in solution. So this VH factor, that's the Van't Hoff factor. Right? And it's just going to be a term that we're going to multiply everything by if your stuff breaks up into more than one thing. We're going to get into a little bit more finesse about that, but basically if your stuff breaks up into two things, your Van't Hoff factor is two. If it breaks up into three things, your Van't Hoff factor is going to be about three. Glucose, molecular solid, only breaks up into one thing, its Van't Hoff factor is going to be one. Okay? So we're going to use our equation to find the molality. And then we're going to use the molality to find the moles, and then grams and moles to find molar mass. So we've got our equation, delta T is equal to Kb times M. Did we know delta T? Yes. So delta T is going to be 100.34 minus 100, so 0.34. And notice that this guy is going to be positive. Kb, we look that up on the table, right? That is in units degrees C times kilograms per mole, or degrees C times 1 over molal. We're going to calculate the molality. We're going to rearrange this equation. We have delta T, we've got K. We're just going to rearrange this all for M, where M is going to be delta T over KB. We said delta T was 0.34. And our K value was 0.51. Right? Notice our degrees C are going to cancel each other out. We're going to be left with units of moles per kilogram, and that's equal to molality. So now we've got our molality. We can find out what our molar mass is. So 0.15 kilograms of water was used to prepare that solution. We're going to use the definition of molality to determine the number of moles of glucose in that solution. So if our molality is moles per kilogram, right, and we've got moles of solute per kilograms of solvent, and we've got 0.15 kilograms, so we know M, we know kilograms, we just need to find N, rearrange that, we get 0.67 moles per kilogram times 0.15 kilograms, or 0.1 moles. So 0.1 moles of glucose has a mass of 18 grams. That was part of our setup. And 1 mole of glucose has a mass of 180 grams, or 10 times 18. So our molar mass of glucose is going to be 180 grams per mole. Freezing point depression. When a solute is dissolved into a solvent, the freezing point of the solution is lower than that of the pure solvent. When the solvent is water, it will not freeze at 0 degrees C, but at a lower temperature, something in the negatives, because water has a lower vapor pressure than that of pure ice, and ice won't be formed. The vapor pressure of ice decreases more rapidly than that of liquid water as the temperature decreases. Temperature at which vapor pressure of the ice and liquid water become equal is the new freezing point, and it is below zero. Our freezing point has been depressed. LSAD. Right. Very similar equation. We got delta T is equal to KF times the molality of our solute. Delta T is our freezing point depression, or difference between the freezing point of the pure solvent and the new solution. KF is going to be the molal freezing point depression constant, and M is going to be the molality of the solute. Right? So things we can do, right? We can say, what is our new temperature that it's going to freeze at? Right? We could say, what was our, if we measure a new freezing point, what was the original freezing point if we know the molality and our freezing point constant? Right? We can calculate like we did before, what our molality is, and then from that, what our molar mass is. Or you can do the very simple experiment and try to find out what KF is. Measure our delta T, measure our molality. So we can be used to determine the molar masses and to characterize solutions. All right, so now we're going to determine the mass of ethylene glycol. We're given its molar mass. So how much ethylene glycol do we need to add to 10 liters of water to get it to freeze at 10 degrees Fahrenheit or minus 23.3 degrees C. We're going to assume, to make our lives easier, that the density of this water is exactly 1 gram per milliliter. So our plan, we're going to find our molality. We're going to use our molality to find the moles, and we're going to use our moles and our molar mass from up above here to find the grams. All right, so our freezing point is going to be lowered from 0 to minus 23. So our delta T is going to be 23.3. We're going to use that equation, delta T, which we just figured out, KF times M. So our delta T was 23.3, right? Our KF is going to be given to us, 1.86. Solving for molality, rearranging it, we're going to get delta T over KF, so 23.3. Degree C, the degree C cancel out. We're left with kilograms per mole, but on the bottom, so it becomes moles per kilogram, 12 moles per kilogram, and that's units of molality. So we've got our molality. This means that 12.5 moles of ethylene glycol have to be added per kilogram of water. We've got 10 liters or 10 kilograms of water. Therefore, the number of moles of ethylene glycol is going to be 12 moles per kilogram times 10 kilograms. We're going to need 125 moles of ethylene glycol. Right? to find out that mass, we've got our moles times our molar mass. Our moles cancel out. We're left with grams. So 7.76 times 10 to the third, or 7.76 kilograms.